People, how wonderful to see you here after we lost an hour of sleep last night. But welcome to Epworth, where we continue to explore faith and embrace community. I thank God for the gift of every single one of you, whether you're here in person or whether you're joining us online. God's love is big enough and strong enough to make us all connected, whether we're in the same place or not. So I'm grateful for all of you. I invite you to give us the gift of your presence if you're in person by signing one of the blue connection pads. And if you're joining us online, just say hello in the chat so that we can know you're here and we can celebrate your presence. Today we are looking at, actually it's the first one in our membership vows, but it's the fourth in our series. Our membership vows are prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness. And so today we're looking at praying and how praying can help us thrive, both as individuals and as a community. So I invite you to allow the Spirit of God to come into your heart as we learn together what it means to be a praying people. I invite you now to rise in body or in spirit as we continue in song.
Oh,
I want to invite the youngest disciples to come forward. We have a special treat today because we have Mr. Doug and Sandy who are going to work with us today. How are you? Good to see you.
Okay. I don't do this very much. I did it 7 years ago, and now I get to do it again. Hi, you little people, and you not-so-little people. How many of you pray? Okay. You pray every night before you go to sleep? Do you ever pray, like, before you take a test? Yeah. Or you pray when you think your parents are going to get mad at you? There's that, please, God, don't make them be mad. So today, Sandy and I are going to show you, we're going to teach you, how you can pray absolutely silently. Do you know the song, Jesus Loves Me? You do? Okay, let's sing through it. Jesus loves me, this I know.
Help him out.
For the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
So that's a good prayer if you just want to say it too. Yes, Jesus loves me. But now Sandy, who interprets for our friends who have hearing issues, our differently abled friends. So can you turn around and look at Sandy? Because she's going to help us learn the sign language for this. So, Jesus, you take your third finger and point to the center of your palm, because that reminds us that Jesus was crucified. So Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. So turn around and look at her. Jesus loves me. This I know. This I know. For the Bible, Jesus' book, right? The Bible tells me so. So let's do that much. Are you all doing this? Good. I didn't have eyes in the back of my head. Okay. Here we go. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones, to him belong. Little ones, yeah, little ones. To God, yeah, belong. That's it. Okay. That's an easy one. They are weak. They are weak. But he is strong. Think you got that? Let's take it back to little ones. Little ones. You're right. Little ones to him belong. They are weak. But he is strong. This should be easy. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. So you could say this, and no one would ever have to know what you're doing if you just do, Jesus loves me. You could do that any time of the day just to remind yourselves, yeah, Jesus always loves you. So let's do the whole thing. You ready? Ready? Okay. And Jesus loves me, this I know. Little ones to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me, the Bible tells me so. Yay, you guys, yay. So, how do you say yay? Yay! Okay, now show us amen. Amen. Let's do it again for him, amen. So that means that's the way it is. So be it. Amen. Amen, you guys. Jesus loves you. You go off to Sunday school and remember this. Yeah, go away. Go. Okay. Thank you, guys.
going to ad-lib this. We are very grateful that you are here, and we appreciate all that you do. And if you have brought a gift to share with the community, you know that we honor that gift through the many, many ministries that we have. We are good stewards of that gift. So there are many ways to give. You can give. There are boxes in the back as you leave the doors. You can give online. You can text to give. You can mail a check to the church. But there are a lot of things going on in the church. One of the things you'll notice is that the website has been simplified. And so when you go onto the first page, there are very easy ways to find ways to volunteer and groups and worship times and all of those things. And also wanted to let you know, or remind you if you didn't know, that today after church, we're going to invite you to go out and get some coffee and a snack and come back in if you would like. We're going to have a brief town hall meeting. We're going to be covering both the Source Collaborative as an update, but also General Conference as an update. And there are just so many, one wonderful thing I wanted to tell you about that's happening very soon is part of our Source Collaborative, our learning community at Epworth. We wanted to bring diverse groups of people together to learn together. And so we have the Pulitzer Prize winning brother of Murray Archibald, John Archibald. John will be Murray's brother, which will be really cool because I'm sure Murray is often John's brother. But he's coming. He wrote a book called Shaking the Gates of Hell, which is a fabulous book if you haven't read it. But he's coming to offer a presentation, and we're going to invite someone from LGBTQ community, someone from the African-American community, because both of those topics are covered in who he is. And so we're hoping that we'll bring some diversity into this place as we share a wonderful time. And it is Saturday night, March 23rd at 7 o'clock, both here, and we will be streaming on YouTube. You don't need a ticket, so just come on out. It's going to be a wonderful, wonderful night. And so please check the website. There are so many beautiful things going on. Holy Week's coming up. There's just a lot of good things. But just wanted you to know that we are grateful for you and all of the gifts that you share with us. And now we'll continue in worship with an anthem.
morning. Prayers of the people, let us pray together. Holy Triune God, when we stand at the edge of fear and worry, you invite us to step into the waters of faith and trust. When we stand at the edge of the world's pain and need, Jesus invites us to step into the land of humble service. When we stand at the edge of our hunger and thirst, the Spirit invites us to sit at the table of grace. God, ever with us, you draw us near to your heart so that cradled in compassion, we might see the brokenness of all who are around us. Teacher beside us, you draw us near to yourself so that by following you, we may discover the deep joy of serving the broken of the world. Spirit within us, you draw us with your peace so that reconciled and restored to God, we may be the healers to a world shattered by despair. God, in community, holy in one, as we draw near to you in this time, we lift the prayer you have taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
My vision is severely impaired, and for that reason, I would like to thank my gifted adopted son, Doug Yadar, who always enlarges and darkens the scriptures that I am to read, and that enables me to continue to be a volunteer to read scriptures here on Sunday. To the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Those he redeemed from trouble and gathered in from the lands, from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south. Some were sick through their sinful ways, and because of their iniquities, endured affliction. They loathed any kind of food, and they drew near to the gates of death. Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble. He sent out his word and heard them and delivered them from destruction. Let them thank the Lord for his steadfast love, and let them offer thanksgiving sacrifices and tell of his deeds with songs of joy. Today, may this scripture inspire us all
to walk in the way that leads to life. Dear Heavenly Father, how grateful we are this morning that we can worship safely here in this beautiful sanctuary. There are millions of people in this world who do not have a place of worship now, or even a home to live in. Help those who have the ability to be of help to them to do so. Thank you, God, for our pastors, Vicki and Bo, for the staff, and for the many volunteers here who help in so many ways. The future is wide open, Lord, for our congregation to reach beyond our walls to meet the needs of so many and share the love of God with them. Bless Vicki now as she shares your message with us. May we open our hearts to hear and to learn from this message. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Ms. Clella. When the kids were little, we started a tradition called birthday blessings. And what happens is, whoever's birthday it is sits at the table, and we do an open-eyed prayer. And we go around, and every single person looks at the birthday person and says, I thank God for the gift of you because, and then they share something. Maybe it was something that happened that previous year. Maybe it's something that they just love about the person. But we've continued those birthday blessings, so much so that last week when I was celebrating my birthday, Joy called out, "We haven't done birthday blessings yet." So we went around and did birthday blessings. And there's something wonderful about that because it helps you feel seen and appreciated. It helps you feel a deeper sense of love and connection with the other person. It helps you understand what they feel is important in the relationship. And it's a wonderful, wonderful gift that we can give to each other. So my son Eli, when he graduated from college, did a similar thing, except instead of us thanking God for him and we were celebrating him, he said, "I want to say the blessing." We were gathered around our dining room table, and he went around and thanked God for each person around the table and said what they had contributed to him as he went through his college journey. And it was a beautiful prayer of thanksgiving. It's probably one of the best prayers I've ever heard, because it was him sharing from his heart his gratitude. Well, today as we look at prayer, we begin with this beautiful psalm, and it starts with a sense of gratitude. "Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever." Remember a couple of weeks ago, we talked about that steadfast love, chesed, and that's that love that never, never ends, that unconditional, indescribable kind of love. But it goes on throughout the psalm to then talk about what happens when you experience that love and how people had strayed from it. And so it talks about, you know, in their wickedness, in their sinfulness, they suffered. And then it goes on to say, but they cried out to God and God healed them, and then back to thanksgiving. So I want us to kind of look at those aspects of prayer as we unpack this psalm today. I want us to think about prayer that connects us up. Today must be the day for hand motions. Connects us up, connects us in, and connects us out. So the first thing prayer does is it connects us to God. It's a way of experiencing God's presence. And really, here's the beautiful gift. The Spirit is already praying in you, so you don't have to come up with anything. So many times I think we feel like we have to say the right words or we have to do the right thing. But the Spirit is already praying in us. And so what we're doing is we're tapping into that Spirit within us. We're allowing God's steadfast love to pour over us. We're just spending time with God. And, you know, I don't know about you, but when I like to spend time with people, I don't want to do all the talking. In fact, I hardly do any of the talking. I like to listen when I talk to people. But, you know, there's a sense of we think we have to talk. But connecting up to God in prayer is more about just experiencing God's presence. God is always, always with you. Always. And so when we allow ourselves to just experience God's presence, it's a beautiful gift because it reminds us that we are loved, that there's nothing you can do to take that love away. And it allows us to share our love back with Jesus. One of my favorite practices that I do and try to do on a daily basis, doesn't always happen, but is centering prayer. And centering prayer, I have a little app, and it takes you through. But you spend 12 minutes just thinking about a word or two that describe who Jesus is for you. So recently, it's been healing love. And so anytime your mind starts wandering about my to-do list or the grocery list or whatever, you go back to that healing love. And, you know, I have an active imagination, and so a lot of times, I just try to focus on looking into the eyes of Jesus. Just looking and being present. Because that's all you're trying to do. It's just be fully present to God. Because God is so fully present to us already. And God longs to know that you desire God's presence just as much as God desires you. And it's a wonderful, wonderful gift. I read a story this week about an 18th century priest who found this old peasant in the church every single day for hours and hours and hours. And so the priest said to the peasant, "What is it that you do for hours upon hours upon hours in this church?" And the peasant said, "I look at God, God looks at me, and we are happy." And to me, that is that contemplative prayer. It's looking at God, knowing that God is looking at us, and finding that place of contentedness, of gratitude, of peace, of just not worrying about anything, because we are in the presence of God. And it's in that presence of God that we begin to learn about who we are and how God sees us. And so after we reach up, that prayer starts to reach in. And we start looking at ourselves, because when we know we are loved, we have the courage to be honest about who we are. We are fully loved and fully human. We make mistakes. We sin. We go ways that God doesn't want us to go. And so we can embrace both of those when we know that we are loved by God. And that gives us the courage to look inward. I want to be careful here with the psalm, because the psalm almost makes it sound like sin is the cause of sickness, and we know that that's not true. Now, we know that there can be some correlation. If you are constantly arguing with someone, then the relationship's going to be sick. Or if you beat your body up, then, you know, your body may be sick. But this is not a direct correlation that if you're sick, it's because you've sinned. I think it's more looking at this sense of, you know, how our body, our mind, and our spirit are all interconnected. And so part of how we pray and we look inward is by recognizing how we treat ourselves and how we treat others. And so we start to listen for God within us. We start to listen for what God is telling us about who we are. And the goal is not shame. And remember, shame is how you feel about yourself. Shame is saying that you're a bad person, and you never want shame. Guilt is a good thing, because guilt says, oh, no, don't go that way. It's like a warning light on your car. You know, the engine light comes on. Guilt is like that engine light. Oh, come on, you're getting into trouble. And so, you know, when we look inward, we begin to see, why is it that we do certain things? You know, what's going on in my heart? Why am I anxious? Why am I angry at this person? What am I feeling right now? And you have the courage to name that before God. And when you do, God gives you that amazing gift of forgiveness. And God invites you to walk a different way. And that's the best part of all, is that forgiveness is wonderful, because then we don't have to carry it around anymore, right? But then God says, there's another way, and it is so much better. So all of this introspection is about becoming more like Jesus, because that's ultimately what we want to do. And so we examine, you know, what is this circumstance that's going on in my life telling me about God? What is God trying to communicate to me through this conversation I had? What is it that God wants me to hear when I'm out running and listening to the birds sing and watching the squirrels chase each other? How is God talking to me in all of this? And as we listen to God, we learn more and more about how God loves us, how God longs to heal us, and then it doesn't stop there. Because when we learn about ourselves and we have the courage to try to live differently, suddenly we begin to move out. So we started up, we went in, and now we're moving out, because when we understand ourselves better, then we start to understand other people better. And this type of prayer is really looking at, you know, intercession, intercessory prayer. It's when we pray for other people. We're connecting our heart to God's heart, and we're trying to bring them in. In the psalm, we hear that, you know, they cried out to God, and God healed them. And so in intercessory prayer, we're lifting people up into the presence of God. I was very blessed. My parents were amazing at intercessory prayer. Every year, they would collect their Christmas cards, and they got close to 400 Christmas cards. Now, they sent out close to 400 Christmas cards, too. But so every year, they would keep them in a basket, and they'd pull out one every day at breakfast, and they would pray for that person. And then, if they had time or if there was, you know, if the situation allowed, they would call that person and say, "We've been praying for you. How are you doing?" And I've had more than one person tell me, "We kept your mom and dad on our Christmas card list because we wanted to be prayed for." But you know, we forget the power of that kind of connection, that moving us outward to each other, because people long to know that they matter. And when you say to someone, "I will pray for you," you are saying to them, not only does God care about you, but I care about you, because otherwise I wouldn't waste my time, right? So I care about you, and God cares about you. Now, here's the thing. We don't know how prayer works, right? We don't know. It's a mystery. And there's a wonderful book that I reread the chapter of this week called Soul Feast, An Invitation to the Christian Spiritual Life. It's pretty old, but it's still amazing. And it's by Marjorie J. Thompson. And she talks about, you know, some of the possible ways that intercessory prayer might work. You know, she said some people think, but she said, because it's a mystery, all of these are just theories, because we never know how it works, right? But she said, some people think we change God's mind. Some people think we change ourselves in that struggle. Some people think that we share our positive life energies with another person who is mystically connected to us through God's love. You know, so there, we are all connected. We call it the communion of saints, but and that includes the people who've gone on before us, but we are all connected as the body of Christ. And so when we put love out to others, you know, that is a part of how we can help them feel that sense of healing. In prayer, we join our hearts in love with the love of Christ, who we're told intercedes for us. And in prayer, we become aware of God's presence. And so, you know, that's part of it too, is that as we pray for others, we become aware of God's love for everybody. When we pray, we can simply trust that God knows what we need. And so there's an element of deepening our trust. And when we pray, we're cooperating with God in willing life and goodness for others. And this one's kind of one of my favorites. Yet we remain vulnerable with God to the limits imposed by evil, limits accepted in the freedom that love creates. So there's this sense that we don't know how it works. And yet there's something powerful in praying for each other. There's something powerful in lifting people up. And some people say, "I don't know how to pray for another person." Well, let me take us back to that peasant in the 18th century. Why don't you just imagine that person and lift them up into the love of God? And then imagine God's healing love just bathing them. You don't even need words. You can just allow the Spirit to surround them so that they can experience the presence of God. And so we don't know how exactly it works, but we do know that it does work. So the John Templeton Foundation has done some empirical studies that show that when people pray for their friends or their spouse or their partner, that they are less likely to be combative, to seek revenge, and that they are more likely to be patient and forgiving and understanding. And so to pray for your significant other or your friends deepens that relationship so that your behaviors are changed. And so there is a beautiful sense that prayer does work even if we don't understand exactly how it works. And so we know it connects us up, and it connects us in, and it connects us out. And that helps us then to thrive, because that's what we all want to do, right? As individuals and as a community. And I can tell you, when you pray for someone that you're mad at, or you pray for the church, including Epworth, or you pray for your pastors, or you pray for your spouse, you do get less irritated with us, with each other, with your spouse, you know, with your friends. You get less irritated. And that impacts the entire community. So when you pray, you're not just praying for yourself. You're changing our entire community. And that helps a community to thrive. When I was in divinity school, I had a friend, and we were pretty close. We were running partners, and we're in a couple of classes together. And in our senior year, she kind of betrayed me. And I was very, very hurt and angry. And so in prayer, you know, I just went to God, and I was like, how could she do this? How could you let her do this to me? What is the matter with her? What, la, 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 you know? Just being honest, because we can be honest before God. We don't have to hide ourselves. In fact, if we hide, then we're not letting God see our true selves. And after I raged for a little bit, then I wept, because I thought, I'm really hurt. That's what this is all about. I'm hurt. This is my trying to defend myself, but I'm really hurt by this betrayal. And then I just started praying, and I happened to be praying through the Psalms, and the Psalm that day was the 23rd Psalm. And so, you know, I'm praying about God leading me beside the still waters and just allowing myself to breathe, to experience those still waters, to let go of all of my rage and my hurt and my fear and just rest in God. And so it was just a wonderful time of just letting all of that drain out of me. In fact, I can feel it draining out of me right now. Just thinking about trusting in God, right? Well, then we get to the part where it says, God prepares a table before me in the presence of my enemies. And I'm like, yes, you're there. And when, you know, when I, in my imagination, in my prayer, I'm thinking at first that, you know, God's going to have me seated at the banquet table. And guess who was seated right next to me? That would be my friend who betrayed me. So it's like, huh, okay, wait a minute. You know, so I'd connected up. Now I needed to connect inward because I didn't want her at that banquet table with me. And it's like, you know, what's going on? What is it going to take? And then I started seeing her and just praying for her. And just, okay, God, I'm tired of raging. I'm tired of seeing her as my enemy. I'm just going to pray for her. And, you know, all of that just allowed me to reach out to her the next day. And we never really figured out, like, what happened. And she never really said she was sorry. But the relationship was restored to some degree. Not like it would be before, but it was repaired and restored. And it brought me such peace not to have to be afraid to see her in the hallway or, you know, afraid she's going to look the other way or betray me again. It was just this sense of trust that God was going to take care of us, God was going to take care of me, and God was going to take care of her. And then you fall back into that pattern of, oh, thank you, God, right? So we start with this gratitude, we end with this gratitude, because God knows exactly what you need. God loves you more than you could ever imagine, and God longs to be present with you. And the way that you do that is in prayer, moving up, moving in, and moving out. And I believe that that prayer is strong enough and is the only thing that has the power to change our world. And I think we can. Will you join me? Amen.
everybody falls sometimes. Gotta find the strength to rise from the ashes and make a new beginning. Anyone can feel the ache. You think it's more than you can take, but you're stronger than you know.
Don't you give up now. The sun will soon be shining. Gotta face the clouds to find the silver lining. I've seen dreams that move the mountains. Hope that doesn't ever end, even when the sky is falling. I've seen miracles just happen. Silent prayers get answered. Broken hearts become brand new. That's what faith can do.
Doesn't matter what you heard. Impossible is not a word. It's just a reason for someone not to try. Everybody's scared to death. They decide to take that step out on the water, but it'll be all right.
Life is so much more than what your eyes are seeing. You will find your way if you keep believing. I've seen dreams that move the mountains. Hope that does. Even when the sky is falling, I've seen miracles just happen. Silent prayers get answered. Broken hearts become brand new. That's what they can do. Overcome the odds. You don't have the chance. But when the world says you can, I've seen dreams that move the mountains. Hope that doesn't ever end, even when the sky is falling. I've seen miracles just happen. Silent prayers get answered. Broken hearts become brand new. That's what they can do. That's what they can do.
Even if you fall sometimes, you will have the strength to rise.
Beautiful. Thank you. There is something about prayer that allows us to rise, isn't there? But you know, there is a warning to this, and I meant to mention it. There's a warning because once you start praying and connecting your hearts to God, you begin to see the world from a different perspective. I had some conversation this week with some friends about Gaza and Israel, and we started layering all of the things that are going on there between, you know, the Holocaust and the generational trauma that gets passed down, between the fear of suicide bombers in the marketplace and the destruction of the Palestinians' homes and livelihoods and the deaths that outnumber the deaths of the terrorist attack on October 7th. And it just, your heart joins with God's heart, and it can be a bit overwhelming. But it's also a wonderful miracle. So I wanted to tell you, I have a quick announcement to make, that we have been blessed for 15 years by the work of Darlene Ford, who has been our office manager, our financial person, and she has decided that she wants to retire. So she is going to be retiring the end of March, beginning of April. So we want to invite you to think about writing her a card. Next week we'll have cards out there and a box for you to put them in. And we'll celebrate her on April 7th, where we will have a cake and a time to thank her and celebrate her. But just wanted you all to hear that and to know that. And SPRC is continuing to make adjustments. And our new office manager, Tammy, is picking up many, many, many of those responsibilities. And we're also looking at things like outsourcing our payroll, thank you. Whoever told me, thanks. And things like that. So, but we wanted you all to be aware, so make sure that over the next month you reach out to Darlene if you can, let her know how much we appreciate her. And in the spirit of today, pray for her, because she's going to have a big transition. She's had her hands full with her parents, and it's going to be a big transition. Also wanted to invite you to these questions for reflection. I'm hoping they're going to show up on the screen. But as you go out and get your coffee and come back in, I want you to think about and turn to somebody you didn't come with and share, what's the first prayer you remember praying? Like, did you learn a prayer when you were a kid? You know, God is great, God is good, or... you know, now I lay me down to sleep. What's the first prayer that you remember? They are on the screen. There we go. What are you grateful for today? What are you grateful for? And do you have a gratitude practice? How do you like to show thanks to others? And how do you express thanks to God? And then if you get time, which you probably won't, but that's okay, describe what prayer is like for you and what practices help you connect with that divine love. So we're going to have a little bit of a break as you all go out and get coffee. It is almost 11, so we'll start back here at 11:15, but that'll give you some time to chit-chat and to come back for the town hall if you are staying for that. But I want you to hear this blessing. Jesus loves you. This we know, for the Bible tells us so. All of us to him belong. We are weak. God is strong. Yes, Jesus loves us. Yes, Jesus loves us. Yes, Jesus loves us. The Bible tells us so. Go filled with that love. Amen.
We want to see.
trust in.